An ideal society should be mobile, full of channels for conveying the change taking place in one part to the other parts. In an ideal society, there should be many interests consciously communicated and shared. There should be varied and free points of contact with other modes of association.
Namaskar, adab and welcome. I'm Aditya and you're watching The Indian Atheist. In a series of recent tweets, Kangana Ranaut laid bare her views on the issue of caste-based reservations in India. I thought it was important to respond to her because hundreds of thousands of Indians follow her on social media and because what she's saying in these tweets seems at least superficially logical, unlike some of her other views, for example, on Deshbhakti and stuff, and also because it's the exact same thing that probably 90 out of 100 upper caste Indians regurgitate in private anyway, and more recently, increasingly loudly in public. For me, there's also a special reason to respond to these tweets that hits close to home. And that is, not more than a decade ago, I thought along the same lines. In fact, back then, I would have written the exact same tweets with the exact same arguments, the only difference being mine would have had proper punctuation, but who cares about that stuff, right? This year is the land of mediocrity, after all. Let's look at the tweets. The first one reads, "Caste system has been rejected by modern Indians. In small towns, everyone knows it's not acceptable anymore by law, and order it's nothing more than a sadistic pleasure for few. Only our constitution is holding on to it in terms of reservation. Let go of it. Let's talk about it." Thank you for that last part. It's difficult to follow the writing. The subject of the tweet itself is misspelled. But that's okay, shit happens. Another one reads, "Especially in professions like doctors, engineers, pilots, most deserving people suffer reservations. We as a nation suffer mediocrity and brilliance finds a reluctant escape to the US. Shame." Is it just me? Or does anyone else detect hints of Trump here? There is a distinct Trumpiness to these tweets. I mean, apart from the vocabulary, of course, which is slightly advanced for Trump. And also, apparently, Kangana hasn't been introduced to periods yet. One is forced, therefore, to look at these tweets phrase by phrase because somehow the notion of a sentence is conspicuously absent in these tweets. So here goes nothing. Phrase 1. Caste system has been rejected by modern Indians. Kangana seems to borrow here, I think, from one of the greatest socio-political scholars of this country, one Mr. Jaggi Vasudev, aka Mr. Sadhguru, who's reportedly known to destroy caste system in 30 seconds or 5 minutes or whatever. The accounts vary. So anyway, according to Kangana, caste system has been rejected by modern Indians. If that is so, how come in Kangana's own industry, the lead characters in almost every mainstream Bollywood movie are always upper caste? How come almost every Indian matrimonial website has a drop-down menu for caste preference? How come almost every priest is Brahmin and almost every worker in the municipal sanitation departments is lower caste or Dalit? How come there are severe punitive measures in place for intercaste marriages in almost every single Indian village? And how come the upper castes dominate almost every vertical of human enterprise in India? Is it because A, upper caste people are actually superior, like DNA-wise or something? Or B, upper caste people simply work harder? Or C, upper caste people have more motivation or a greater urge to succeed in life? Or is it D, the rigidly institutionalized social hierarchy that we call the caste system that continues to deprive the lower castes of equal opportunities? You have these competing hypotheses, now apply Occam's razor. Go ahead, apply it now. It's as good a time as any to get some hands-on on Occam's razor. Select the one that needs the least number of assumptions. Done? Good. I hope we can all agree that it's option D. If you choose anything other than D, we'll do a separate episode on Occam's razor and hopefully you'll come around. The point is, caste system is not by any means dead just yet. It wasn't more than a century ago that Dalits wouldn't be allowed to drink water from the wells or lakes reserved for the upper caste people. Please note that I'm not talking about dignity or self-esteem. I'm not talking about jobs or means of livelihood. I'm talking about water, the primal requirement for life. Our country has been incalculably injured by the caste system, we can't even begin to estimate in how many different ways it has repressed a whole section of our society. You think you can wash off a stain like that in a mere handful of generations? You'd be wrong. Caste system has been around for thousands of years. You can't just expect it to disappear in thin air in the mere 7 decades since independence. We are a big country, Miss Kangna. Things take time here, you know? Caste system hasn't been rejected by modern Indians. It has only been swept under a carpet. The worst part is the carpet is fucking see-through. Phrase 2. In small towns, everyone knows it's not acceptable anymore by law and order. Is that so? Order refers to the executive part of the law and order duo. Let's, for the purpose of brevity here, not talk about order. Let's just talk about the law. Order will follow. It's supposed to anyway. Name one small town where the caste system is not acceptable by law. Or name one big town. Fuck it. Show me a single square inch in India where the caste system is not acceptable by law. Okay, fine. I don't want to be the moron here. I'll give her the benefit of the doubt and assume that she probably meant that discrimination based on the caste system is not acceptable by law. But so is rape and corruption and murder and employment without minimum wage. None of these things are acceptable by law. Does that mean we don't have rape or corruption or murder or unlawful exploitation of labor? Just because something is unacceptable by law doesn't necessarily mean that it's unacceptable in society. Case in point, rich assholes mowing down poor people sleeping on the curb or shooting endangered animals. It's perfectly unacceptable by law and yet somehow perfectly acceptable in our society, which is why, even after the fact, we keep watching their fuddu films year after year. And also, just because something is acceptable by law doesn't mean it's acceptable in society. Case in point, homosexuality is now acceptable by law. But try coming out as gay or worse, lesbian in India, and you'll know the difference between what the law dictates and what societal norms dictate. Phrase 3. It's nothing more than a sadistic pleasure for few. She's not wrong here, I think. Caste system is nothing more than a sadistic pleasure for few, which means for almost no one. Let me just check that once again. Caste system is nothing more than a sadistic pleasure for almost no one.
Wait, what?
Which means caste system is merely a sadistic pleasure for almost no one.
Wait, what?
Which means caste system is merely not a sadistic pleasure for almost everyone.
Wait,
what? Yeah, I think that makes sense. What? I did cut her some slack before, but I'll be damned if I'm reduced to a machine that corrects her grammatical mistakes. Phrase 4. Only our constitution is holding on to it in terms of reservation. Right. What did the sun rise in the west today? Our society is holding on to the caste system in terms of arranged marriages. Our private, organized, and unorganized sectors are holding on to the caste system in terms of caste-based discrimination in jobs. The elite of our society are holding on to the caste system in terms of feigning victimhood at the hands of the perceived injustices of reservation. Our constitution is thankfully one of the only things that's not holding on to the caste system. It is trying to annihilate the caste system through affirmative action, which is not another worldly notion, by the way. Almost every civilized modern democracy has some or the other form of affirmative action in place for the marginalized. We are not doing anything that most developed societies haven't already done. Affirmative action is logically and ethically the only way to close the chasm between the privileged and the underprivileged. That's how you make the world a better place to live, not by building fancy flyovers or by flashing your fucking smartphone every time you want to pay for a paltry cup of tea. Hashtag fuck cashless. Hashtag fuck it to smithereens. Fucking cashless. Phrase 5. Let go of it. Sure, we'll let go of it. When it is damn time to let go of it. It'll come. Be patient and be prepared to wait for at least another half a century. In the meanwhile, if you really want to fight reservation, there is indeed something you can do. Marry intercaste nahi hoga aapse. Kyun nahi hoga? Caste dekh ke shaadi nahi karoge. Fir kya dekh ke karoge? इंसान देख के शादी करोगे? पागल हो क्या? आज तक किसी के बाप ने इंसान देख के शादी की यहाँ पर? हमारी महान सभ्यता और परंपराओं को चूना लगाओगे हैं? इंसान देख के शादी करेंगे? चल झट्ठे। Phrase 6. Especially in professions like doctors, engineers, pilots, most deserving people suffer reservations. I'm sorry, but I'm gonna have to say this. Doctors, engineers, and pilots are not professions. They are people who are employed respectively in medicine, engineering, and aviation, which are indeed use Grammarly or something, you know. There's no shame in it. I mean, she's talking about merit and the pursuit of excellence here, isn't she? As someone who has often been mocked for the lack of posh English speaking skills, as someone who did not benefit from the ideal city girl upbringing or the Bollywood royalty lineage as far as the entertainment industry is concerned, and as someone who has been very outspoken about these issues, you'd think that Kangna will understand the role of privilege endowed by birth. But clearly, her interest in the matter is limited only to proving how she herself has been the victim of the lack of a variety of top-tier privileges, which is why we have no compunctions whatsoever about mocking her grammar. She's a big girl. She's a fighter by birth. She can take it. Anywho, in response, I'm going to try and pull off Inception in your mind. For this to work, as you know very well, the idea has to be very simple, right? Here's a simple idea. Two girls, one rich, one poor, both get the exact same test scores in a pilot's exam or something. Based on their test scores, both are indeed pilot material. But who actually deserves the job? Now what if the rich girl is not only rich, but all sorts of rich, and the poor girl is not only poor, but all sorts of poor, and the poor girl's test score is just slightly less than the rich girl's? Based on the test score, of course, the rich girl gets to be the pilot, but who among the two actually deserved the job? What if in the poor girl's performance you were to take into account the history involving a systematic deprivation of means and methods that runs back in her family for hundreds of generations? There, Inception complete. Now all you have to do is sleep over it. It was worth a try. So yes, Miss Kangna, you're right. In the professions you mentioned, just like in every other profession, the most deserving people do indeed suffer the reservation of privilege that we've already granted to the upper castes. The caste-based reservation is merely a means to restore balance, and a highly efficient one at that. Perhaps it is this remarkable efficiency that's a cause of concern for you and yours. Show me a single patient scorned by a Dalit doctor, and I'll show you 10 scorned by upper caste doctors. Show me a wonky bridge designed by a Dalit engineer, and I'll show you 10 designed by upper caste engineers. Show me a plane crashed by a Dalit pilot, and I'll show you 10 crashed by upper caste pilots. So yeah, that argument cuts both ways, and it cuts a lot fucking deeper on your side, our side. It's best not to use it and make a fool of yourself. Phrase 7. We as a nation suffer mediocrity and brilliance finds a reluctant escape to the US. We as a nation suffer mediocrity because that's what happens when you rob in broad daylight half of the population of the opportunities to freely, fairly, and meaningfully contribute to the economy, and also of the dignity that comes with it for thousands of years. Mediocrity is what you get when you let filthy religious dogmas run roughshod over reason or basic human decency. If our mediocrity is because of reservations, what explains India's poor contribution to science and technology before independence, or before the British Raj, or before the Mughal Sultanate when the caste system was in full swing? Were we inventing calculus? Were we thinking about magnets or electricity? No. We were busy burning widows on the pyres of their deceased overage husbands. We were busy doing nothing apart from fighting amongst ourselves like cats and dogs, while the lower castes did all our work for us, without fair compensation and without dignity. It is competition on a level playing field that fosters excellence. A level playing field is precisely what the caste system is not, and a level playing field is precisely what reservations aim to achieve. So if you really want excellence, you should be rallying behind reservations, not ranting against it. And as far as brilliance finding a reluctant escape to the US, I'm sorry, that's just plain ridiculous. Do you think people who leave India for the US do so reluctantly? Have you seen someone who just got an offer from a US firm, or a student who just got accepted by a foreign university? Reluctance is the last fucking thing on their minds. You think if we shut down the whole system of reservations, that'll put a cap on people escaping the country? They escape because India My India, I don't know about your India or Mr. Sadhguru's India, but my India is a backward country. India is a backward country, most of all, because of the caste system. It is the single biggest reason we are where we are. It is beyond a shred of doubt India's biggest enemy ever. And India, meaning we, the people, all of us, needs caste-based reservations like a tumor needs fucking surgery. Kangna has also written and said some other fantastic stuff on this issue, but sadly, for now, we are out of fucks to give. We'll have a lot more to say about the caste system in the future though, because let's face it, what else is there in Hinduism, right? वो सब अद्वैत वेदांत वगैरह जो है ना, घंटा कुछ नहीं रे, भरे पेट खाली भेजे की बातें ये, न्यूयॉर्क शिकागो जाके बेवकूफ गोरों को ठगने की तरकीबें हैं सबकी सब, अरे हम पब्लिक है भैया, सब जानते हैं. Anyway, I hope we've made our position clear. The Indian atheist wholeheartedly and unequivocally supports caste-based reservations. We do, however, maintain that the apparatus that grants the non-creamy layer certification should be made more transparent and foolproof so that the benefits are not abused and so that upper caste belligerents like Kangna and myself from a decade ago may have one less excuse to wage war on the institution of paramount importance, that is, the caste-based reservations. The Indian atheist takes this opportunity to salute the real greatest socio-political scholar of this country, indeed one of the greatest in the world, the one and only Dr. Ambedkar. If you want to know what true scholarship feels like, read Ambedkar. Not being acquainted, at the very least, with this stellar intellect is a damn pity for any Indian who calls herself an atheist, period. Until next time, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening. Dhanyavaad. Shukriya.